Good morning. Welcome to the Community Voice. I'm Steve Gradick, your host. Delighted to have you with us on this beautiful Monday morning. Happy Columbus Day and greetings to all that are listening. We thank our sponsors, Oak Mountain Academy and Tanner Health System. We're very pleased to have in studio today two gentlemen. And what we're going to be talking about is Pregnancy Resource Center. We've had them on recently, but this is a special event coming up, a very important one. It's called the Pastors and Church Leaders Summit, equipping your church to minister to your community in a post-Roe America. It's going to be October 27th, 6 to 8 p.m. at City Station. And of course, main thing, dinner is provided. Yay. Mm-hmm. Our guests this morning are Pastor Chris Altman, Tyus Baptist Church, and Pastor Micah Gentle, Pleasant View Baptist Church. One's north of Carrollton, one's south of Carrollton.
Got it covered.
Yeah,
right.
Well, yeah, the most important thing. Chris Altman's pastor at Tyus Baptist, former youth pastor at Rootville Road Baptist for 22 years. Shout out to Stephen Peoples. Attended seminary at New Orleans Baptist and Southeastern Baptist. He's a father with a daughter and a son and a husband. Suzanne, married to Suzanne. Micah Gentle. Since 2007, he's served churches in Georgia, North Carolina, upstate New York, Tennessee, Alabama. He's been preaching since he was 16 years old, and currently you're what, 22?
I'm 33.
Uh-oh. He grew up in Tallahassee, Alabama. Never heard of Tallahassee. How big is it?
It's pretty small.
Earned a Bachelor of Arts in Christian Studies at Union University in 2011, Master of Divinity in Christian Ministry from Southeastern Baptist Theological Seminary in 2015. Married to Kristen, and he has one daughter. Well, gentlemen, welcome. Thank you for coming in.
Thanks for having us.
I got two Baptist preachers.
That's right.
So so that'll be fun. If I get a word in, you forgive me.
You're
for
doing
that.
Pretty well, right?
That's right. Let's start off. It's been a monumental year this year when Roe v. Wade was overturned, almost a half century, and we unfairly asked Micah his age, but mine's a lot older. So I was there in 1973, June 22nd, and since then, they say the public number is 63 million children who have been aborted in America. Well, that number is grossly understated. Two states never reported. California was one of them. And when Clinton came in at the last year, we started chemical abortions. So a more reasonable number, who knows, is, God knows, but it's probably about 100 million or so. And of course, they unfortunately didn't grow up to be adults and have children. One of the biggest historical situations in all of American history, Roe v. Wade, abortion on demand. What do y'all see in terms of the role of the church now in a post-Roe America as we now go, it goes back to the states? How do y'all see it? Whoever wants to go first.
Well, I think it's different for both Mike and myself. I was 6 months old when Roe v. Wade came about. And so everybody now, the majority of people in the churches, they have no all they've ever known was Roe v. Wade. Mm-hmm. And so now we're living in some new time to where it's all new. What do we do with this? And so, but I think for the church, the message and the tactics really stay the same. It's just to love God and love people. How can we best do that? Now, of course, it's going to be different now in light of these new decisions because the animosity really changes sides, or the direction and the attacks change sides. So the church seems to be happy with this, but what does it all mean? Well, I think that's where the church can step in and point to resources like the PRC, to point them to resources that they may have better answers than the church has as far as Roe v. Wade.
Chris?
Yeah, that's all right. Yeah, I would say, the biggest thing that the Dobbs decision has done is actually revealed that the best tactic for the church in fighting abortion and in saving life has always been resources like the PRC. And the experts have always said that the laws will do far less than people coming alongside expectant mothers and unplanned pregnancies will always do. And so it actually kind of just reveals what the best tactic always was, which is actually loving people and caring for them and finding ways to meet them in their need.
Back in the 70s and early 80s, the pro-life movement was criticized because there wasn't these outreach-type ministries to women in need, to women in crisis. And And over time, and I'm sorry, I can't remember the stats, but I think for like every one abortion clinic, there grew in numbers that there were like 10 or 12 or more pregnancy resource centers. From being pastor and pastoral counseling, et cetera, how do you see PRCs and the outreach of the church and of the gospel?
Well, I think it's definitely an arm. It is the greatest resource the church has for fighting abortion and for helping life. The most vulnerable person in the world is the person in the womb. They have no voice. Well, who's going to speak for them? Well, the PRCs of the world in our country are. And so where the church, the hands aren't tied, because our arm and aim is to preach and teach the gospel, to live out the gospel. But then specifically on the political realm, or just them knowing how to do this, PRC knows. The church doesn't need to reinvent the wheel. It just needs to point to it. And so that's I think the greatest tactic we can have and do. And it's a beautiful resource to have, especially people that are in it to win it, like Carmen and the staff. They're phenomenal. Mm. And so it's just a great blessing for every church, and specifically West Georgia area.
Yeah, and people don't just come up to churches anymore like they used to. People used to go to churches. You know, you can even read in the early church and Middle Ages where babies would be dropped off at church doors and left, and the church was known as a place where, for whatever reason, they'll take care of their kids if they don't want it. We just don't live in that world anymore, where churches are seen as safe places for people who have no connection to a church. And so because of this, the PRC is. And so by us supporting them, it allows us to reach much further than our arms would ever go.
Well, what can it mean to the members of your church when this is a avenue whereby your church members can put works to their faith and can demonstrate their faith, and give that, I think oftentimes referred to in James as, the works itself to demonstrate your faith. What kind of blessing can it be for your church members?
I think just the blessing of seeing lives saved and lives changed, because I think the misconception is that the PRC is only out to change the mind of the abortion-minded person and individual. I mean, naturally, that's the case. I mean, we do want to do that, but they're there for the person, to minister to the young lady and the young man, or the older lady or the older man. I mean, it's to pour and speak life into them. But to see your monies, because giving is the greatest thing that the church can do to the PRC, to come along their side, to pray for them, to give to them, and then to go. The go part is the part that you don't see very often, because it's a private institution and you want to respect the privacy of the patients and the people that are coming in. And so a lot of times it's just the giving. And I know I can speak for the West Georgia churches. They've got a fundraiser called the Baby Bottle Boomerang, which is a phenomenal thing. You fill up a baby bottle full of change or paper money. And so I think this year the churches in our community gave close to $110,000 by putting change and cash into baby bottles, which is phenomenal. I think almost equaling what the fall fundraising event would pull in, which is the big donors coming in and being fed a great meal and listening to a great speaker and asked to give money, and they do well. But the churches also do a great job of giving. I think that's the greatest way for the church to put action behind their faith, is to come along side through financial giving, obviously.
Our guests this morning are Pastors Micah Gentle and Pastor Chris Altman, and we're talking about the Pastors and Church Leaders Summit coming up October 27th, 6 to 8 p.m. at City Station. We'll be back with more after these words.
Health is a journey. It's making better choices, even when it's not easy. It's taking care of yourself and the people you love. At Tanner Health System, we're there for you with every step, with primary care, heart care, cancer care, women's care, orthopedics, surgical services, and so much more. We're dedicated to helping you live and feel your best. So let's get on that journey to health. You've got places to be for many years to come. Find us at tanner.org.
As a believer in the power of education, we are called to set the standard by shaping and empowering the minds of future generations through quality education. Oak Mountain Academy embraces this philosophy, which is why my children attend this prestigious school. I am elated to serve on the OMA Board of Trustees, where together we prepare students and remind them to trust and believe in the power to transform the world. I'm Dr. Brian Bain, inviting you to celebrate our 60-year legacy of academic excellence. Visit us at oakmountain.us.
Good morning. Welcome back to the Community Voice. I'm Steve Graddick, your host. Delighted to have you with us this morning. We have Pastor Micah Gentrell from Pleasant View Baptist Church, and Pastor Chris Altman from Tyus Baptist Church, and we're talking about the upcoming Pastors and Church Leaders Summit for the Pregnancy Resource Center, October 27th at 6 to 8 p.m. Dinner will be provided, and we're encouraging all pastors and church leaders to join in this ministry as they serve their clients throughout, and have been for a long time here at the PRC, serving Harrelson, Carroll, and Harrelson counties. You know, the word these days is that politics follows culture, but culture follows the pulpit, does it not, to a point? And what y'all preach and teach on Sundays and Wednesdays and throughout all time really defines a lot of what we see in America, be it what we've seen with the Roe v. Wade, which is now thankfully overturned. But how do y'all see your role behind the pulpit preaching the word in terms of affecting culture and then eventually affecting politics?
I think, you know, one thing that I've really realized over the last 4 years probably or so is that we as pastors need to do probably a little better job of connecting dots for people from the principles in Scripture to real life examples, whether it is a political question or a cultural question. I think oftentimes we take things for granted. I was in a conversation not long ago with a man that I trust and respect, and he had some very simple questions about why do we not believe in abortion. And I realized we really need to come back to a lot of the basics and connect a lot of the dots for a lot of our people, and not take things so for granted. And so I think we do need to connect some dots. I think we need to be careful about connecting too many dots and pushing our preferences and opinions on people that go way beyond Scripture. But I think Scripture speaks to a lot of culture and a lot of politics, if we're being mindful about it. And what's difficult about that is that it probably most likely will not fit neatly or evenly into a right-left box that we have in America right now. And so that pushes you in a weird, awkward spot oftentimes. But if you can manage that, navigate that, I think it could be a prophetic voice in our time.
Yeah, I would agree, and I'm very simple in this. Just let's just tell people what the Bible says, and again, not try to put it in a box. I think people are getting very emotional. We're coming off the last, you know, 8-16 years to where politics was very emotional, and more than ever, you saw clear divided lines, and then those lines were very emotional. So the tendency is for the pulpit to say what pleases the people. And I think that's a major error that a lot of pulpits and pastors are in. We want to please the people rather than please our God. And I'm just reflecting back to the Acts passage where Peter and John are taken before these leaders early on in the church's history, and they're preaching a message that the culture doesn't like. And they're confronted by these leaders, and then their response to them, whether it pleases you or God, you choose, but we're going to obey God rather than man. Well, that's a difficult position to be in, because the people pay, and the people preserve you, even though we know God, above all, preserves the people and sustains us and redeems us. But man, we do want food on the table. and so a lot of preachers and pastors, they begin to please the people, but then they get the pats on the back and they get platforms. And so we equate that with success. And so I think, above all, be political in as much as the Bible gives you permission to be. So how do I determine that line? Well, preach Scripture. Mm-hmm. Just say what the Bible says. Let's be that simple. But then I love the point about answering the specific questions. And we do need to do a better job of helping our people see. Don't avoid the situation, but take them to the resource that will give us the best answer possible.
Mm-hmm. In both y'all's minds, is Scripture very clear that the life in the womb is human life created in the image of God?
I don't think there's any question about it. But I also don't think there's any question that science proves that life begins. It's actually, to believe that personhood and life are distinct, it has to be one of the most like new age spiritual beliefs you could have, that a human being can have human DNA, can be a living being, but not have personhood, is something that only some mystical religion could believe. And so those who want to defend it based on scientific reasonings have no standing. So I feel like not only does Scripture support it in terms of he knit me together in his womb, a verse that we talk about often, or John the Baptist visiting and celebrating the incarnate Jesus in the womb. I don't know how you can get past that. But I also don't feel like I have to support it based on Scripture. I believe if I was an atheist, science would push me toward being pro-life.
Right, and that's the logical side that we can approach in a situation like this, because some of the images we're able to see now, the 3D images, I mean, used to you've got a dot and you're really having to squint to see, are you telling me that's a child in there? And then to determine the gender of that child is even tougher unless you're a trained, you know, nurse. But now you can tell and you can already begin to see in the womb, well, that favors the dad or that favors the mom. And so how can you not say that that's a person? Mm. Well, and then it always comes down to, well, what determines if somebody's actually a person? Well, we would say a heartbeat maybe is a good place to start. But yes, science, I mean, makes it a lot easier for us to know when life begins. And Bible kind of, you know, begins that thought. But if you're an atheist or whatnot, and, I mean, how could you disagree with that? It comes down to emotions. What do you want to believe? That's what you're going to fight for.
There's so much here, and we could probably go for a long time in that vein. And maybe one day we can come back and do just that. What do you say to Christians that are... when we talk about these issues, and of course there's rejoicing, if you will, that Roe v. Wade was overturned, but the church and Christians in general don't really need to be demoralized or subverted in any way because God is still sovereign. And after almost half century of Roe v. Wade, I mean, he's still on the throne. Mm-hmm. And so whether it's culture or politics, mm-hmm. or whatever it is, he is sovereign. Any comments there?
I would just say amen.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and, you know, one of the things that we've seen even over the lifetime of Roe is that abortion did decrease.
Right.
That we, and you may ask, well, how could that possibly be? Well, it's why we're here, but it's because of people like the Pregnancy Resource Center. The pro-life movement said, if we can't win the political battle, or until we can, let's focus on the culture and the hearts of men and women and potential moms and dads. And that's really where the battle is fought anyways.
How, when you see, and I know you have, and this is probably an unfair question, so y'all can skip over it. But when you see fellow pastors and preachers and ministers and other church leaders taking a different approach than you two gentlemen, how does it make you feel? In other words, if they say, no, we're not going to talk about abortion, that's too divisive, or we're not, you know, or we're going to leave that up to whatever. How do you see it when the church doesn't have one voice? And that's in many things in history, the church sometimes has been divided, and sometimes it's just been a minority of the church that would speak out and speak, like in this case, for life. How do you reconcile that? What's y'all's views on when the small remnant of the church is the one who's standing for the gospel and for truth?
Well, naturally, anytime anybody disagrees, you're hurt with any topic. I mean, with college football teams, you know, whatever. We get our feelings hurt. Well, this is a major thing because life is at the very point of the discussion. But, I mean, it's a human rights issue is what it is. We're fighting for human rights. But I think it hurts. You wish they would stand on the truth. But at the end of the day, I don't know that I'm not as strong as Paul would be to go and oppose these people and speak, but I know that I'm responsible for the sheep and under my care. I'm going to do my best to lead them. We've got enough issues in and of ourselves, but pray for those people. I think prayer is that. We celebrate what God has done in spite of those other voices in opposition. But we just pray for them and reach out as needed. But most importantly, you minister to those under your care is where I would go.
Yeah, you know, and unfortunately, the church has gotten questions wrong before. We weren't the leaders on civil rights. We weren't the leaders on abolition wholesale. We certainly had some like Wilbur Wilberforce and many in America who were. But as a whole, we didn't do the best job of leading out in those things, unfortunately. And so there has been times where it has been a minority of believers who had to be that prophetic voice, if I could use that language. On my best days, I think seeing those who disagree with me on abortion causes me to wonder, is there another area where I'm missing the clear implications of Scripture, where I feel very confident that my political beliefs are flowing out of the Bible and I'm just completely wrong?
So, in a lot of ways, supporting and working with and volunteering with a PRC, in this case, the Pregnancy Resource Center of Carrollton and Heard, allows us to not only demonstrate our faith, but to keep that right perspective in so many ways.
Well, definitely. I mean, not only are you able to put faith into action, but you're helping to form our belief, you know, in that faith and understanding of what that faith represents. I mean, an understanding that the PRC is not a Baptist thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's an ecumenical, non-denominational thing to where they're fighting for a cause that we as believers, no matter the denomination, should rally behind through our finances and through our efforts and prayers. So somehow we can agree that this is needed, right? And then when a church or a leader is like, yeah, no, not really. Well, then you draw back and you're like, okay, well, I think if that's not an issue for you, I think, as Micah said, there's some other underlying issues going on, and I need to start thinking if we're actually on the same team. You know, are we? I mean, I think it would be that severe. We're talking about life, and I know you bring the sensitivity of the woman into play, and there's other situations, and you can understand that situation a little bit. Brings the emotions into it. It all comes back to emotions, I believe, and we could go many different ways with that.
It does see the PRC of most ministries has that ability to unite people. It seems like it's one ministry that kind of cuts across all.
It's boundaries. A clear line. It yeah. cuts a sharp line to where you're either for it or you're against it, as they used to say.
Yeah.
And it really does.
But it has a broader appeal, I think, to most for a number of reasons. Well, we're going to take a next break. We'll be back to wrap it up with Pastor Gentle and Pastor Altman. But first, these words.
Health is a journey. It's making better choices, even when it's not easy. It's taking care of yourself and the people you love. At Tanner Health System, we're there for you with every step, with primary care, heart care, cancer care, women's care, orthopedics, surgical services, and so much more. We're dedicated to helping you live and feel your best. So let's get on that journey to health. You've got places to be for many years to come. Find us at Tanner.org.
At Oak Mountain Academy, we value our grandparents and special friends. Throughout our 60-year legacy of excellence, our grandparents have been a vital component to our success. Friday, September 30th, we celebrated their generosity and continued support at our annual Grandparents Day celebration. Please join me in thanking all of the grandparents for their amazing contributions to the lives of their beloved grandchildren. I'm Patrick Uran, head of school. For more information, visit us at oakmountain.us. The Warrior Legacy, celebrating 60 years of excellence. Warrior-minded, warrior-driven, warrior-led.
Turn up the microphone. I will. Thank you. Welcome back to the Community Voice. I'm Steve Gradick, your host, and we're on Facebook Live if you'd like to share any of that. We're going to be talking about the PRC's Pastors and Leaders Summit. They'll be presenting strategies for ministry in the new season in our country post-Roe. Dinner is provided, registration is required, and all pastors in the West Georgia area are encouraged to attend, as well as key staff and leadership. It's Thursday, October 27th from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. City Station on Maple Street, RSVP. You can go to the Pregnancy Resource Center to register, I believe. And what would you say to other, y'all give me your best invitations to this event. to other pastors and church leaders as to why they should join y'all in participating in this?
I can't think of any person or organization other than Carmen and the PRC to help me navigate through what all this new stuff means. Mm-hmm. When it came out, I was celebrating, but in a sense, I was like, okay, what just happened? I knew it was good. I knew something evil was overturned, but still I needed help in understanding everything that decision brought forth. Mm-hmm. And so as serving on the board, Carmen was able to help me and the board through, all right, this is kind of what it means, but still a lot left to be unsurfaced. So I think for that reason alone, I don't know of any person that truly knows. So I can go on the internet and find out, right? Yeah, you can find out something, but I don't know if it's going to be the truth. Right. So for pastors, for church leaders, staff, anybody interested, we're not going to turn anybody away. I don't believe Carmen would do that. There's a seat here for you to best understand not only the implications of Roe v. Wade, but also what you as a person, as a ministry, as a church can do now in light of this. So why not come? You get a free meal. And so come and hear, be equipped to serve your community in the best way possible. So just to make sure we're clear, to register, if you see a poster in town, there's going to be a QR code. You can scan that QR code. But if you want to go to the website, the website address will be thepregnancyrc.com/events, and that'll take you to the registration page. So that's pregnancyrc.com/events to register. So please come. It'll be great.
Yeah, you know, and I would just ask a church leader, what will you say when the unexpected mom comes and asks you questions? Because the truth is that I don't know exactly. That's one of the main reasons I'm excited for this event, is to hear some, you know, some encouragement and some training on just what will that conversation look like, and how can I have that conversation well. You know, the question for me of abortion is simple, but once that question turns into a conversation with an abortion-minded woman, that conversation is no longer simple. And so I'm excited about this event for hearing some about that, hearing about where we stand and what we as a church can actually do to come alongside the PRC and to combat abortion and to be pro-life.
So that's an important point. Y'all just don't preach on Sundays and take the rest of the week off. I mean, y'all are counseling and doing all kinds of unlimited number of things. So the PRC is a resource for all pastors and church leaders to, as you counsel and as you direct people, women in crisis. And it's not just women, it's the father. That's you right. know. And That's so, right. you know, we want to not forget them and bring them in the loop whenever possible, I would think.
And it's not just for the birth of the child either. There's resources after, you know. There's I know our church specifically, many churches, we help provide diaper bags. We're trying to help them after birth too, with parenting classes. What's the next step? So it's just not something that the PRC and the churches are just trying to get a, you know, another mark. You know, all right, we did something good, or we saved another life. That's to be celebrated. But let's not forsake that life now outside of the womb, or the parents outside of the womb. Let's walk with them. And that's even, I mean, if they were to choose abortion, the PRC is still there for them, not to provide care for that, but to provide counseling after the fact. And so I think that's the bad message that the country is getting, is that the PRC is one-minded. Well, it's not. It's for the whole person.
And to minister to the woman who's living in fear that moment as to what to do and how to move forward.
Yeah.
Well, gentlemen, thank you for coming in. Thank you for your work with the Pregnancy Resource Center and Carol Harrelson in Heard County, Pastor Micah Gentle of Pleasant View Baptist Church, and Pastor Chris Altman of Tyus Baptist Church. Again, the event is October 27th, coming up from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. at City Station on Maple Street, RSVP. And we thank you for listening. Go out and make it a great day. You're in tune to WLBB Carrollton.